So you want to be a cowboy? Partner? Well, you're not the first, and you certainly won't be the last. Yep, the genre of Western and cowboy games seems to be more popular than ever. But when did it all start? Well, oil your saddle, grease your gun, and let's journey across the wagon train to find out where it all began. And maybe we won't get shot along the way. I don't know what it is about Wild West cowboy games, but it's always been a type of game I've had an interest in. My first experience with this type of game was back in the days of my Commodore 64, but you need to go a lot further back in time to find the roots of the Western game. Right back to the 1970s, in fact. Now, I'm not going to list and chronicle every cowboy Western game, and this video certainly isn't a chart to find the best. All I wanted to do when making this video was to trace the history of the genre and find out how we got to where we are today. So, let's roll. Yes, you need to go back to 1971 to find where it all started, when a little known game was made by Don Rarich, who was a student teacher at Carleton College in Minnesota. Rarich was tasked to create an educational unit on the mid-19th century Western expansion. Eventually, after many hours of planning his lessons on paper, his roommates and college student teachers Bill Heineman and Paul Dillenberger suggested this could be a good idea for a computer program. The program was completed in just 2 weeks using the school's HP 2100, and the Oregon Trail was born. And yes, while this is essentially an educational program, it is a game too. The game lets you take control of the leader of a wagon train, and you must purchase food, bullets, clothes, along with other supplies, whilst at the same time avoiding and surviving encounters with snakes, raiders, and the elements, until arriving at Oregon and completing your adventure. The original game didn't even have a monitor, but relied on a teleprinter. But due to the program's popularity, over the years it would be developed and remade on mainframes, and eventually made the leap to home computers in the 1980s. The game is recognized for its cultural significance, and is often listed as one of the greatest games of all time. Pretty cool for a program that nearly never existed at all. The next Wild West game would arrive only a few years later. Wild Gunman by Nintendo arrived in the arcades in 1974. Now, the arcades in the 70s were in their infancy. Games like Pong and Grand Track 10 were pretty simple by today's standards, but Wild Gunman took itself to another level. The game was a light gun shooter, but it wasn't strictly speaking a video game. It was actually an electromechanical system using a rear projector. This was way before the likes of Laserdisc, and was shot on two 16mm films that were essentially synchronized and would display one of the two images depending on whether you won or lost a round, which was simply to shoot the bad guy before he shot you. In fact, it was the first arcade machine of its kind, and that type of cutting-edge technology comes at a price, as it was nearly three times the cost of most other arcade games at the time, and as such, is incredibly hard to come by in the wild today. However, the essence of the game would be remade 10 years later for the Nintendo Famicom, and would be a release title for the NES. It wasn't long though until the world would get its first Western arcade game that was actually a video game. Gunfight arrived in 1975, and as well as being the first Western game that was actually a video game, it was also the first game that was a one-on-one person combat shooter, as well as being the first video game to use a microprocessor. Designed by Tomohiro Nishikado of Taito, the game lets you go head-to-head and shoot each other across the screen using cactus trees and wagons for cover. The game was hugely successful for the time, and reportedly sold over 8,000 units, and even went on to have a sequel called Boot Hill. Like Wild Gunman, the game would even be ported, appearing on the Bally Astrocade and Atari 8-bit, and if you're lucky enough, you can sometimes still see them in the wild. By now, the Western arcade games were starting to become more popular around the world, and the golden age of arcades had begun. It was around this time that home video game consoles were becoming more popular, Atari with their 2600, Bally Astrocade, and the Intellivision to name but a few. So it wouldn't be long before we would see some cowboy western games appearing on the various new second generation consoles, with ports of Gunfight and Outlaw being two of the earliest games to be released. However, it wasn't just arcade ports that were being released. Stampede by Activision was released in 1981 and was one of the California based company's first games to be made. The game was programmed by Bob Whitehead, one of the original founders of Activision, who had already had success as one of Atari's earliest programmers and even worked on some of Atari's launch titles. Stampede may not see you take control of a gunslinging cowboy, but it does put you in control of a cattleman, with the aim of rounding up all the cattle without letting any of it slip by. The game proved to be popular and gained good reviews. The game would also be released on the Mattel Intellivision later on in 1982. However, it would be the growing popularity of the home micro in the mid 80s that would see some of the best games of the time get released. High Noon for the ZX Spectrum was released in 1983 by Workforce and was inspired by Taito's Gunfight. Again, it was two players and played much the same way, but it was High Noon from the Commodore 64, a completely different game, that I got my first taste of the Wild West. The Commodore version was released by Ocean in 1984, and like I said, was in no way connected to the Spectrum version. The game consists of multiple levels where you play an all-in-white sheriff, where you have to rid the small town of outlaws who are looking to rob the local bank and even kidnap the ladies from the Saucy Sue's bar. The game allows you to move around and shoot in multiple 2D directions. It was a great little game and had a nice little tune too. By now, we were in the height of the 8-bit home micro age, and titles were getting released on multiple formats. West Bank was based on the 1984 Sega arcade shooter Bank Panic and was released in 1985 and available on the Commodore 64, ZX Spectrum and Amstrad CPC. The game was published by Gremlin Graphics, and like the original arcade game, it's a first person shooter that lets you take control of a sheriff whose job it is to protect the bank from robbers in an old west town. The game is definitely fun to play, and the music on the Commodore and Amstrad version gave the game a really nice upbeat feel. The game would go on to be released on the MSX and the Sega Master System. 1985 also saw the release of one of the most original Wild West titles to be made so far on home micros. Lore of the West by Alan Miller for the Commodore 64 and Apple II was a launch title for the newly formed Accolade. Miller was one of the original Atari 2600 programmers, along with Bob Whitehead, David Crane and Larry Kaplan, who all went on to form Activision. Eventually, Bob Whitehead and Alan Miller would leave to create Accolade with the aim of making more games for the growing home micro market. If you want to know more about Accolade, I cover this in a previous video, and I'll put a card in the corner for you. The game itself is a type of graphical adventure and lets you take the role of a sheriff in a small town sometime in the Wild West. The aim of the game is to make it through till sunset alive, and along the way, upholding the law by running out drifters and stopping the local gang from robbing the bank. It has some really nice little details, such as if you happen to shoot too many people or don't treat the doctor right, then he may not save you if you get shot. This was by far my favourite Western game at the time, and I loved playing it in different ways to get different results. The game received mixed reviews, and while people said it had impressive graphics, it was also said that the game was too short and had limited repeat playability. Whilst home micros such as the Commodore 64, ZX Spectrum, Amstrad CPC and Atari 8-bit were having success, the arcades were benefiting from more powerful hardware than what you could get on home computers, and were seeing success with such games like Data East's Express Raider and Capcom's Gunsmoke. However, it wouldn't be too long until we would see the next step in video games taking the Wild West to a whole new level. In the late 80s, a company in New Mexico were manufacturing training simulators for the police force using a combination of cutting-edge software, laser discs, and light gun technology. Robert Grebe, CEO of American Laser Games, saw how much police officers using the simulator were enjoying the experience and realized at that moment that he could turn this into a video game. That idea would become Mad Dog McCree and was released in 1990. The game was completely live action and filmed on location in their home state of New Mexico. Now, this wasn't the first time Laserdisc games had been made. Games had been released on the format for quite a few years beforehand, starting with Astron Belt in 1983. Astron Belt was first released in Japan by Sega some 18 years earlier, just before Dragon's Lair. Laserdisc games allowed a brand new approach to gameplay like never before. Filmed and animated sequences allowed for a greater storytelling and immersion, which is precisely what Mad Dog McCree was able to take advantage of, and allowed you to take on the role of a gunslinging protagonist whose job it is to rescue the mayor and his daughter, who have been kidnapped by, you guessed it, a bunch of outlaws. When the game was released in 1990, the Laserdisc game industry had long seen its peak, but Mad Dog's glossy live action and on-location set helped the game's success and topped the arcade charts, and was successful enough to spawn a sequel. It also received ports to home consoles at the time. But surprisingly, powering the Mad Dog McCree arcade game was a couple of Commodore Amiga 500 home computers, albeit with a few hardware additions including a Genlock and a Laserdisc player.
Sega Saturn.
Aww. Hit it!
Sega's next generation gaming platform. Revolutionary sports and arcade.
With the golden age of arcades at an end, the games consoles started to get more powerful 16, 32 and even 64-bit systems. The games console industry saw a slew of Western games released across various different consoles at the time, most of them some kind of arcade shooter. Some of them good, and some of them, well, not so good. Quantity doesn't mean quality after all. But after a few years, FPS or first-person shooters were taking advantage of more powerful consoles and computers. Games such as Doom by id Software and Duke Nukem 3D by 3D Realms were growing in popularity, and in 1997, LucasArts would put their Jedi game engine to work with the release of the first-person action shooter Outlaws. This game lets you take control of James Anderson, a retired US Marshal who has to seek out and kill a bunch of outlaws that have killed his wife and kidnapped his daughter. One of the great things about this game is the way it tells you the story, with numerous stylized cutscenes that help with the immersive feel, but it's the brilliant full orchestral soundtrack that lifts this game to another level. That, along with some great voice acting by John DeLance, as well as Richard Moll and Jack Angel.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Is the marshal in?
He ain't a marshal no more, sir.
You afraid of dying, kid? Keep that fear.
All this added up to give the game a cinematic feel not seen in this genre before. Hardware was starting to be more capable of much more than straight arcade shooters, and their 3D games were well and truly here. And in 2004, the Wild West got another dose of the 3D world, with a game that would eventually spawn a franchise. Red Dead Revolver came along and was released on both PlayStation 2 and Xbox. However, unlike Outlaws, this was a third-person game, and the many cutscenes were seamlessly played within the game with no need for loading screens, giving the game greater immersion. Like many Western movies and games, this was a tale of revenge, as Red Harlow, a bounty hunter on the Western frontier, pursues revenge for the death of his parents, who were killed after finding gold. The game is ultimately an action-adventure told in a linear style and contains various NPCs as you navigate the game. However, the game could have looked quite different, as it was originally intended to be a spiritual successor to the 1985 Capcom game Gunsmoke, and have more of an arcade feel like its original counterpart. However, the project was cancelled before the studio was purchased by Rockstar, who rejigged the game into what we recognise today. The game would go on to sell nearly 1 million copies by 2010, and has since been released, or re-released, on the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. By now, 3D games just seem to be everywhere, and games like Gun by Activision and Ubisoft's Call of Juarez just kept coming. However, there were other Western-based games coming out too that weren't 3D shooters. Desperados 2 by Atari was a real-time strategy game, Capcom's God Hand was a classic beat-em-up, and Wild Arms on the PlayStation Portable was a turn-based role-playing game released in 2007. But it would be 2010 when a franchise would not only build on its original success, but would elevate the Wild West to a whole new level. And on the 18th of May 2010, Red Dead Redemption opened up a new world of gameplay for the genre. The game was released on PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360 to critical acclaim. Now, what I'm going to do here is bundle Red Dead Redemption and Red Dead Redemption 2 together, because I could easily spend 15 minutes or so talking about each one, so I'm just going to talk about both of them here as one. Both games would be full open world adventures, unlike the original Red Dead Revolver's linear approach. And like the original, the new games would have great stories and allow you to fully immerse yourself in the Wild West, and along with its unique features like taming horses, hunting, fishing, and even playing poker, it was hard to run out of things to do. This is all before we take into account the brilliant side quests available, and if all that is just a little overwhelming, well, you can always just look at the view. I mean, just look at it. It's absolutely beautiful. The developer Rockstar truly and completely pushed the boat out with these games. And Red Dead Redemption is now 10 years old and it still looks amazing today. The details on the characters and the background are so well put together. Both games would go on to win multiple industry awards, and while Red Dead Redemption 2 would go on to sell nearly double the amount of copies as the original Red Dead Redemption, some people, however, would say that Red Dead 1 was the better game. Between them, they have sold around 45 million copies, and the Red Dead Redemption story continues with Red Dead Online, as people all around the world can come together and play online on Xbox, PlayStation, and even PC. Furthermore, the chances are we'll probably get a Red Dead Redemption 3 at some point in the future, although we may have to wait a few years yet before that one rides into town. And that pretty much brings us up to where we are today, but by no means is it the end of the story. Games of a Wild West theme are still being released today. Open world adventures, role playing and strategy. You can even still get the more simple top down arcade game. And as for that game that started it all off, well, the Oregon Trail has received a fresh new modern update in April 2021. So to finish, it seems we have come full circle. And whilst I don't know what the future holds, I expect new Western games to continue to be released for some years to come. Personally, I'm waiting for Red Dead Redemption 3, but I think I have a bit of time to play Law of the West in the meantime though. Thank you for coming with me on this Wild West adventure. If you've enjoyed this video, then maybe you can give it a thumbs up, and if you'd like to see more, then please subscribe to the channel. I've been the Retrobyte, until next time, see you later y'all.
Are you the sheriff of the stinking town?
What's it to you, punk?
Damn, I've been shot!